Thank you, Derek. Well, a first aid kit is an essential item to have in your family home as it ensures that you are prepared to handle any injuries. But are you using your first aid kit correctly? Well, Rosemary Hayden from the Irish Red Cross joins us now as we continue our first aid series. And today we're getting advice on what you should do when someone suffers a head injury. Good morning again, Rosemary.
Hi, Ciara. Thanks very much for having us back.
Poor victim here again.
Poor Pat, yeah.
But this is quite serious. And I do think, particularly I think when it's parents and their children, they do get worried when somebody gets a knock to the head.
Absolutely.
So we're going to start with, I suppose, something that a lot of parents do fear, which is concussion.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, and that's the thing. It's a very, very sensible thing to be worried about head injuries because you don't get a second chance. We always treat conservatively. So we treat for the worst and we hope for the best because it's much better than the other way around. So what we're going to do today is poor old Pat, is literally in the wars on a weekly basis now at this stage. As you can see, Pat here is cool and he's flushed and he's showing signs of concussion. Now, concussion as a result of a bang he got to the head. Now,
and what are those signs of concussion?
Yeah, those signs of concussions would be he would be cold, he would be clammy, he might be a little bit confused, he might not remember what happened, so he got a bang to the head and you ask him, what happened, and he's not able to say what actually happened because he's not entirely sure because, he's a little bit confused. He might or might not have lost consciousness, so if he hasn't lost consciousness, that still doesn't, clear us.
And as we see here, there's a bruise,
has a big bump here, he has a bruise to his eye, and another thing that we would check is that we would check what are his pupils like? Are both of his pupils now? We're not going to worry about dilated, not dilated, and whatnot. Do they both look the same, and do they change in reaction to light? So getting him to close his eyes with the hand over the eyes to cover off all the light, and then allowing him to do that, and we're going to see are they both the same, and they are, which is great.
Okay,
that's good news.
So look, this is when it happens within the home. You're probably going to take whoever it is that's affected to the GP or
Absolutely.
To the A&E, but you want to do something yourself immediately.
On your way there.
So
what you're going to do is
first thing
is we have a bump here. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the ice pack, which you're going to find in your pack. Now, if you don't have your pack to hand, you're going to use frozen peas, something frozen out of the freezer. These are commercial ice packs. You give them a punch to activate them. They're a single use only. So once you've activated them, they won't go cold again. Okay, so this one, you're going to wrap up in your tea towel.
And would you always do that?
Always. Okay. We never put the cold pack onto a wound. And Pat is able to hold that himself. Now, if he wasn't able to hold it himself, obviously we would hold it for him. And if there was any danger of Pat losing consciousness, we'd have him on the ground. We're doing the recovery position. We're going to show you that in another week.
Okay, and why should you not put the cold camper straight onto the head?
Yeah, like we were talking about with burns, this would be a cold burn. So that would be a cold burn. So we don't want to, it's like where, you touch off something in the freezer and you get stuck to it. So that's a cold burn. So we're not going to do that.
Now, sometimes I'd be afraid, am I going to put more pressure on the bruise? Am I going to make it worse?
You can see now that Pat is holding this himself. So he's not going to push in too far or hurt himself. So we're using the casualty. The casualty is able to assist us here and he's able to make sure he doesn't put too much pressure on it. Okay. So now, quick change. Pat is now after developing compression. So Pat is going to swing around here for me. Okay. Phantom of the Opera style. And Pat is now going to show us what it looks like after the casualty has developed the head injury for a while. Okay, so concussion is going to show up, kind of the signs and symptoms of concussion, I should say, are going to show up straight away. However, the signs and symptoms of compression are going to take a little bit longer to develop.
Okay, so let's talk about compression because I think most people have never heard
Everyone's heard the whole, they kept her in overnight for, concussion. Nobody knows about compression. Compression is literally pressing. So if you imagine, Pat has something here where there's a bump. There's, it could be bone, it could be blood, it could be anything at all, but it is literally pressing on the brain. So you can just imagine if you had somebody pressing.
It's just as dangerous.
Actually more dangerous. So compression, if Pat has something pressing in his brain, you can just imagine the most horrendous headache you would have. It would literally feel like something is pressing your head in a vice.
And is that the symptom that they will
vocalise? An absolutely horrendous headache. They will find it very difficult to verbalise. They'll find it very difficult to talk to you to explain what's going on. Horrendous headache. They will have red, warm to the touch skin, and while he was cold and clammy when he had the concussion, he now is red and dry skin.
And there mightn't be any bump or bruise
there might
at
not
all.
Be at all, at all. So there could be nothing.
It's a heat thing almost.
It's exactly. So you can feel him warm and dry and he's complaining of a terrible headache. Now with compression, this is a medical emergency. It's 999, it's off to the hospital in the ambulance, and we're going to be very, very careful about how we move Pat because we don't want to disturb if there's a clot forming, if there's a bleed in his brain, if there's a broken bit of bone that's, you know, kind of going in or anything like that. So we'll be very, very careful about how we treat
it. And how quickly could that form? Could that happen?
It could happen very, very quickly. You know, the thing is, that's why we always keep an eye on the concussion, because we don't want compression to develop while we're still at home. We want the person to be already in hospital, being checked out and everything when that actually shows up.
Okay, but is there anything you should be doing?
Now, what we should be doing is we call 999, we're going to keep Pat nice and warm and cosy, and we're going to use our foil blanket, which is in our pack here. So the foil blanket you'd wrap then around Pat. I won't do that just for pressure of time. What I am going to show you is how we treat a small wound if we have one on the head. So Pat has a wound on the head here, and this is separate entirely to the concussion and compression. This is just a small injury that you may have to treat. Now, if Pat had that injury somewhere around here, we'd be able to roll the bandage around. But since he hasn't, since it's up in the top of the head, we're not going to be able to do that. So I'm going to show you an interesting little bandage that might help.
Now, Pat, if there was something in the cuts, let's say a piece of glass.
We're not going to take out anything that is large.
It.
No, no. If it's just grit, you can clean that out with your
antiseptic
wipe. Exactly. So Pat is going to hold that for me. I've checked there's nothing sticking in or out of the wound, and Pat is holding the dressing on.
And what did you put on there?
Just put on a, this is just a clean sterile dressing. So you'll find clean sterile dressings in the pack. You're going to open them out. You're only going to touch them on the edges, and then you're going to place it straight down on the wound, and you're going to make sure that you have enough space around the edges that there's going to be clear space around the edge of the wound.
Okay, so not just the wound itself.
Exactly.
You're leaving a little bit of extra
space. You need to make
sure
that you have extra as well. So taking out your triangular bandage. Now, we're doing this specifically so that people get a chance to see that the triangular bandage, people often think of it only in relation to slings, but this is a very, very versatile bandage. And basically, the triangular bandage, you'll find them in your kits, and they have a base, which is along the long side. They have a point, which is the apex. And what we're going to do here is we're going to put on a bandage type called the Capeline bandage. And with Pat holding there on the top of his head, I'm going to place this over, and I'm going to ask Pat to hold it to the front. Spot on. I'm going to bring it down to his eyebrows. Okay, no further. All right. I'm going to cross over at the back of his head, at the nape of his neck. Now, I'm not tying a knot or anything. I'm just crossing them, literally just crossing them over.
Yep.
I'm going to bring the two lengths around the front. So what you're looking for is basically the Hilda Ogden from Coronation Street. Yeah, absolutely.
And what is that, just the best way
The issue with that is that if somebody has hair, they're not going to be able to, you're not going to be able to stick something onto the hair. This as well, what's really fantastic here is that if Pat goes a little bit to the side, you'll see the tail of the bandage here. What we can do is I put my hand on the top of his head and I pull on the tail, and that tightens up all around the bandage, around his head.
Just to be clear,
yes,
that's the triangle bandage.
Yes.
People will be familiar with it because they use it for slings, for shoulder injuries.
Yeah. Yeah.
What you did was put the triangle at the back.
Exactly.
And then tied it around, and then of course you have the triangle bit left over.
To the back, absolutely. And then what we're left with there is a very comfortable bandage. It's not going down into Pat's eyes, and it's keeping nice even pressure on his head, and also great for a selfie. Isn't that it, Pat? Already?
Now, what happens if somebody has got a banging headache and they're looking for a paracetamol or a Nurofen? Would you give any medication?
Yeah, now that's the thing. For first aid purposes and for a head injury, there are indications that first aiders are allowed to give aspirin in case of a cardiac incident. But if it's a case of somebody gets a bang to the head, they're out playing, you know, football or hurling or whatever, and they get a bang to the head, no, we don't recommend anything that's going to mask their symptoms. We always treat head injuries as a medical emergency until and unless they've been cleared and everything is okay.
Okay, wonderful advice as always. Thank you, Rosemary.
Not at all.
And we'll see you for your next
first
aid lesson very
soon.
Coming up after the break, we'll be checking out this week's big movie releases, including the movie about Hans Solo. Stay tuned.